So the talk is about Jarpa's Sumner conjecture, and this is with Matthew and another. I think you know Manu Basavaraju, both of my ex-PhD students. And now this is the third one is Karthik M. He was a student of Manu, and yeah, we all jointly guided the student. So that's what we should say. Okay, to introduce this Gyarpa's Sumner conjecture, 940. So this chromatic number is a important parameter of the graphs. Everyone knows that. And what interests graph theorists is what is it that keeps the chromatic number high? So, for instance, if the chromatic number of the graph is very high, what can we expect in the graph? The first answer, so when the graph theory started, people might have told, oh, it is due to the clique, big clique. That is what in any class, when I ask this question, people say, oh, it is clique. But it is not the clique because there are graphs. What happened to this? Anyway, so it looks like it is not getting, maybe because of the other operating system. What is that? No, I have written it well. Maybe because it is in the office, it is open now. But it does not matter because I'm good at telling things. So this is just a guide for me. What was I telling? Yeah, the in fact, there are graphs with high chromatic number, but the clique is quite small. So the but this just for what exactly this connection between the clique number and chromatic number might have fascinated the graph theory community for some time. And the greatest example is the perfect graphs. There was actually the research in perfect graph had dominated graph theory for several years until it got settled in 2002 or 3 or something. Strong perfect graph conjecture was Paul Zimmer, Maria Chudnovsky, and Robertson. They settled it. And so this says the perfect graphs are graphs. Essentially, people want to know what graph classes have chromatic number is equal to clique number. So, but the question is not well formed because you can always take any graph and then find out its chromatic number and put a clique of equal number of vertices somewhere, and then make say, see here, the clique number is equal to chromatic number. It does not make sense to ask the question. So therefore, you have to ask it more properly, more correctly. So the class of graphs where the clique number is equal to chromatic number for every induced subgraph. Now the question becomes interesting, and it is quite interesting, and it has a lot of structure, right? So this was going on for quite some time until it got settled. But then, so this seems to be quite bad. So everything is goofed up. So is it possible to get another laptop which has a Windows system and but why can't this display here? Why does it be hitting? Because in so you can there is a this I think Saket has Windows, no?
I don't have Windows, but mine works.
Works.
Windows. Like I have a software.
Oh, come.
This is
your system. and beginning. Yeah, so now it's working, no? Yes. Yeah. Working.
Yeah.
Okay. So that settled the issue. Sorry, it takes a. So I was not expecting that this is a exclusively PDF place. In IAC, many times it is a confusion when I am asked to give a talk in the faculty hall once, and then okay, it was PPT there. Everybody is using PPT, and because you can put easily these pictures and all, it becomes a little. So I also learned it. I thought that it is easier to do that, so I stopped using PDF. So okay, anyway, we talked about perfect graphs, and after the perfect graphs, this question naturally comes. So what the kind of graphs where the chromatic number can be controlled by the clique number, the biggest clique, the cardinality of the biggest clique has a say on how big the chromatic number can go, right? The graphs where chromatic number is bounded above by a function of the clique number. These are the chi-bounded graphs. So usually we will say, give me some fixed graph H. Then now consider the class of graphs which are H-free. That means H does not appear as an induced subgraph in it, right? And then this graph has this property that every induced subgraph is also H-free then, right? If H is not there in the graph, then no induced subgraph can also cannot have. Typically, we take H-free graphs and we ask if it is for some H. H can be anything. It can be triangle, it can be a cycle, it can be a clique, right? Given size, fixed graph it is. And then if the H-free graph, if it is an H-free graph, can I say that the chromatic number is bounded above by some function of the omega, right? Omega means clique number. So these kind of graphs are called chi-bounded graphs. Clique number of the graph, given graph. Clique number of H is a fixed one, no? There is, does not make sense to say omega, F of omega, right? So F, H is a fixed graph here. We are considering the class of graphs which are H-free. H is not there as an induced. So now in each graph there may have different chromatic number, but then the chromatic number of each graph there will be an F of omega, omega of that G, right? Though they, Paul Seamer and Scott in their survey calls it an ideal of H-free graphs, right? So they have this terminology, but I don't like so much, so then I keep using it. But those people who like that can use that word also. So instead of H, you can have multiple subgraphs, right? You can say H1, H2, H3. None of these things should come as induced subgraph can also be told, right? So that is F-free, if F is a family of collection of graphs. Then I should mention that most of the time, our family is a finite collection of fixed graphs. So that is what we are going to talk about. But on the other hand, it can be infinite also. For instance, you can, perfect graph itself is like that. It is all the odd holes and odd anti-holes, right? That is what is forbidden there. Or in fact, if you forbid only the odd holes, then also it is chi-bounded, because the chromatic number will be a function of, that's a recent breakthrough from Seamer and Chutnowski and Scott. It was also a conjecture by Garfas, but it was settled. The function will be quite high, 2 to the power omega plus 1, something. But then it is also an interesting fact that the clique number is actually controlling the chromatic number in such graphs. But now we are not talking about infinite families. We are usually typically a small set of this thing. So I guess Karthik will be giving a talk later where very specific patterns will be asked to be avoided, and then he will give you very tight bound using omega, right? 1.5 omega, right? 3 by 4 omega, all that kind of bonds, 4 by 3 omega and things like that. But in this is more generic. We will have all the graphs together, maybe whatever is possible will have to be avoided. So we will study this in the more generic setup, because that is the Gaffer-Sumner conjecture we talk about. So then when you ask about, suppose some graph is not there as an induced subgraph, then can the chromatic number be bounded above? It is not true. Even if it is a triangle that we are forbidding, triangle free graphs, chromatic number can go any high, because once you forbid the triangles, it is the clique number is just 2 now, right? So we will, if it was chi bounded, we should have some constant as an upper bound for the triangle free class of graphs. But we know that there are triangle free graphs which has arbitrarily large chromatic number. There are several well known constructions like Mysilskian, Nesser graphs, shift graph, a couple of others also, but let's not get into the details of how they are constructed, but it's well known. In a graph theory class, usually this is one question which comes first. Oh, is it the clique number that bounds the chromatic number? No. Then suppose if it is triangle free, then is the chromatic number bounded? For instance, you look at bipartite graph, it's only 2 there, right? But then triangle free graphs are not, all triangle free graphs are not bipartite graph. So we will have a hope that probably 3 will be enough, 4 will be enough looking at. But then it so happens that it can go to million also. Does not matter. That is the thing. And then the next natural question people ask is that, okay, forget about triangle. Then what if I forbid some CK, the cycles, right? I have no sense of time now. How much shall we fix? It is 9:50. When should I stop? Because I prepared for around 45 minutes. I lost 10:30, we can stop, right? Okay. Because I had to adjust the pace accordingly. What was I telling? I was telling about the forbidding the cycles. Then long, big cycles, suppose 1,000-length cycle is not there. I mean, up to 1,000-length cycles are not there. The girth of the graph is greater than 1,000. You will really, if you have some intuition about the graph, you will really think that it is 2-colorable, maybe 3-colorable, maybe 10-colorable, because that's the way it looks like. When you look from one vertex, you see only trees around, right? A tree growing out. You will think that maybe one white color here, black hair in the next hair. Okay, at some point of time, you will start meeting and then you will be able to manage. But it so happens that by a very famous result of Erdős, which we very enthusiastically teach when we teach a probabilistic method course, is that there exists graphs with whatever girth you fix, right? That much girth, and whatever chromatic number you fix, you can fix it much bigger than that. It exists, right? You can, by some randomly selecting itself, you get, in fact, lots of them exist, right? So therefore, that also is not true, even this H. So this suddenly reveals some interesting fact to us. That means, okay, what kind of H should I forbid so that it becomes chi bounded, right? The chromatic number becomes an upper bound on. So immediately we see that, oh, that H cannot have any cycles. Because if such an H is there, if some graph is there, if that is not there in the graph, then the chromatic number is getting bounded. So then suppose that H has a small cycle in it, small cycle or some 1,000-length cycle or something, some fixed length cycle is there in that. Then you can take Erdős construction, so which does not have that kind of cycles, right? And the chromatic number you make as big as possible. So then, but suppose H should come then, right? So the, but H has also this cycle, right? So that contradicts. So that is not possible to have. So which essentially tells that, we can't have any such patterns which has a cycle. If H is a graph with a cycle in it, so you cannot get chi boundedness just by that, forbidding that. So now you should you look at what is left. Only trees are left, right? Trees and forests, in fact. When I say trees, it's forests. Forests are left. So if you forbid some forest, that means this forest is not there in the graph as a inducer graph. This class of graphs you consider. Now, can I say that there exists a function of this forest and the chromatic, the clique number, such that it's upper bounded by, the chromatic number is upper bounded by f of t comma omega, right? So this is exactly what he conjectured. I mean, at this stage, he thought, okay, enough is enough. Let us conjecture now, right? Now, he says that, okay, Gyarfas and Sumner, no. Gyarfas conjectured and Sumner conjectured. They conjectured independently. In 1975, the first one. In 1981, the other one. They conjectured that this is, technically it is written, if the chromatic number is bounded by t, consider the graph class, so which is chromatic number t, and sorry, clique number at most t, and it does not have a particular tree. You can fix your tree t, and then you can find a function f of kt such that if the chromatic number is going beyond that, that tree will definitely come. Right, and this is true for all trees. Therefore, if you take the biggest of this thing, once you fix the trees on a certain number of vertices, then you can say that give me two integers k and t, and then now consider f, there exists a function f of kt such that for all graphs whose chromatic clique number is at most k, and then if the chromatic number is going beyond this f of kt, then you can expect all trees. All trees on t vertices, I thought k for clique number and t for the trees, right? All trees on t vertices will appear as the induced subgraph, as induced subgraph. So this is all trees, right? So this is what he conjectured. But of course, as I told you before, in Seymour and there, I have reached the Gyarfas-Sumner conjecture, and I am repeating it. If it is this class of graphs ideal defined by H freeness, right? And then all forests are chi bounding is what he says, because for a H free graphs have a chi boundedness. That means a function such that a function of omega bounds chromatic number. We say that H is chi bounding. That H has this special power to control. The absence of it kind of controls the chromatic number, right? H is chi bounding is the terminology. So this is where we are there. Now, Gyarfas-Sumner conjecture just says that all forests are chi bounding. Now, forest is not required, because then you can do a little proof and say that trees are enough, because that will imply trees. From the tree you can get forest also. So now this conjecture was there for quite some time now, as you say, 75 onwards, right? And people were interested to know what is this chromatic number about. You all know that those people who have worked with graphs and its chromatic number a little bit will know that it's a little slippery parameter to capture, right? What exactly it is. You can color it, but you don't completely understand why it is this global behavior of this chromatic number. So people were always interested, so to understand, this was Gyarfas was one guy who kept on giving this kind of conjectures and about the chromatic, high chromatic number, what it causes in the graph, right? And the known cases of this Gyarfas-Sumner conjecture I think I lost some of them here because it was but anyway, there are all stars it is done, and some brooms. Okay, let's say these are special kinds of trees. Trees of radius 2 and some trees which can be obtained by some subdivisions, but it's quite limited, you know. I mean, that kind of trees are forbidden, we know that. But you know, they are always small trees, right? But still, you can have other trees. I mean, forbidding other trees, right? Will you allow this thing, but bigger trees are forbidden. Will it still happen or not is not clear. I mean, it's very clear, very understandable that if you don't allow very small stars and all in the graph, it gets very structured, right? Then we can have some structure theorems, which actually will be able to describe the graph. Oh, this should be like this, this should be like this, very clearly. Yeah? But then we say that very big trees and all are forbidden. That will be much more difficult to understand what is happening to that. You are allowing small trees, but big trees are forbidden, right? So bigger and bigger things, the structure will become very unclear. But we are saying that, so the, you're right. So what will happen to them? So in that sense, this conjecture, the Gyarfa-Sumner is wide open. I mean, it is not, it's not even touched in that sense, only when very small trees are done, right? Patterns are done. The only one level, two level trees are done. So there is quite open, right? But this is about Gyarfa-Sumner conjecture. But then we can tell a lot of things about Gyarfa-Sumner conjecture, but our talk is about variants of Gyarfa-Sumner. So therefore, I have to move on. So the variant we are talking about here is a strengthening of this question, right? So now you consider directed graphs. Now all edges have a direction, right? Oriented graphs. Now the chromatic number does not change because we give the directions, because it's the same definition. I mean, chromatic number is defined with respect to the underlying graph, right? And then now you should talk about oriented trees, not just trees, right? And we ask whether this particular oriented tree will appear as a induced subgraph if you keep the chromatic number quite high, right? So now nothing has happened. We just have given directions both to the input graph and the pattern graph, right? So that pattern should be also particular. Now there are many more choices. Given a tree, you can orient it in various ways. For given a star, you can orient its edge to a leaf. Inward or outward, and there are actually 2^2 k possible orientations coming out of itself, right? So the therefore so this question is a strengthening of the earlier question. So is it still true, TS induced subgraph? So now, but it so happens that in general this is not true. The first Kierstead and Trotter, they showed that there are triangle free graphs even without this directed path. Suppose if you forbid this direct, so for instance you can keep the chromatic number quite high. There exists some triangle free graphs and give some orientations. And you can make sure that its chromatic number is quite high, but still this path will not come, this directed three paths. So forget about with some bounding some clique number and asking this question. Even clique number is also undirected. All these parameters are again with respect to the underlying graph, but only thing is that we have now directions to the edges, right? So, and the pattern we are looking for is a oriented structure, a tree with a specific orientation on it, right? That will be drawn on the board and we'll be searching for that in the thing. But otherwise, the chromatic number is evaluated with respect to the underlying undirected graph only. Similarly, clique number is also with respect to. But now this clique number itself does not make sense to ask because it's not working even for triangle free graphs. Right, so then there was this Gyarfas himself told that there is another pattern. So this is there should be a middle vertex here. So three path, this orientation also will not work. That means we can make sure that the chromatic number is very high, the graph is triangle free, and this does not appear. So then what are the remaining orientations for the three path? These are the two remaining orientations for the three edge path. This Seymour, Chudnovsky, and Scott, they settled that these two things are chi-bounding. That means if you make sure that in an oriented graph, these two patterns does not come, then you are you can get the chromatic number bounded, right? And of course, when you talk about this bounded, now they are very big numbers, right? Like I told, 2 to the power, or maybe at least 2 to the power something. Yeah, this is, I don't know, these are very small patterns. And then, yeah, but you will think that that finishes the trees, no, because that is only 2 length path, because so you can see that now if you take a bigger tree, a directed 3 path cannot be there, right? So if there are 2 levels, if you, it's possible to orient it in such a way that directed tree path comes, no? So therefore, the question of giving an arbitrary tree and asking for all orientations is now ruled out, right? Because you can always get these stuffs inside it, which is not allowed, not possible to get, no? They're not chi-bounding. So, but then still, given a tree, there are some orientations left, which does not have this kind of patterns. Still, we can ask that question. For this particular tree, can I have, if it is avoided, can I make sure that the chromatic number is bounded above, right? There are a lot of clumsy questions left now. The only tree for which all orientations can be asked are stars, as you can see, because if there are 2 layers, already this 2 length path is coming. You could have oriented in such a way that 2-3 length path, right? Because 2 length, because even in a 2 layer star, you can go like to the road and then like this, right? So that's already 3 length path. So therefore, it's not possible to ask that question beyond the stars. But or stars, they are settled. They told that, okay, if it is star, all orientations are chi-bounding. That means if you make sure that, okay, this is my orientation for the star, and if I want to, if I make sure that this orientation does not appear, and then it is the chromatic number will be bounded. But beyond this, general question cannot be asked. Give me a tree and all orientations. No. So, but still, you can take a big tree, and there will be some carefully constructed orientations, which avoids all those counterexamples. And still, we can ask, okay, if this is forbidden, then can I make sure that the graph is chi-bounded, right? Chi-bounding. So the yeah, of course. I mean, this is a place again. I have to stop and think what can be done. So they have it looks, you can take a tree and consider some specialized tree, and then consider some orientations, and then ask, oh, whether this orientation is not there, is the graph chi-bounded? But it looks more and more clumsy, as you can see. There is no generality in that questions. No, you should get more and more specific about special trees and special orientations and all, right? Maybe it is getting more clumsy. People still are working on it. A lot of people are trying to do that. I don't know. Still, as far as I am concerned, the nice orientations like in branching or out branching, that means if you start from a root, always go downward or always go upward. This kind of nice orientations are already ruled out because of these counterexamples, right? So we have to go for some kind of strange orientations which avoid that. Of course, the orientation still exists. But that, so let us forget about it. That looks too clumsy to track. So what, the otherwise what we can do? See, these all these counterexamples happen for triangle-free graphs. All these counterexamples happen for triangle-free graphs. Now you can go to the next layer of specialization. You say that, okay, now I cannot hope to get it for in graphs with higher clique numbers, even for triangle-free graphs. Now, usually the negative side we go, like we told in the cycles, we say that make the cycles bigger, right? Now make it C4-free, right? After triangle-free, it's C4-free. Now we ask this question, in C4 free graphs, do we have the theorem? So it so happens that this is what we are proving. Our main result is once we are taking the C4 free graph, and then the oriented version of the Gyarfas-Sumner conjecture is true. That means you can give me any tree, fixed tree. It can be, let it be on 1000 number of nodes also, but let it be fixed. And then you can decide your orientation, does not matter. Then you tell me that consider the class of graphs where this tree with this orientation is not appearing as induced structure. Then we can say that it is chi-bounded. That class of graphs has to be chi-bounded. Chi-bounded means there exists a function, right? Suppose there are S vertices in the tree, some F of S will exist, will bound the chromatic number. The good thing is this, that function is quite nice. It's not like the Ramsey theoretic functions, which they all say, like super exponential, 2 to the power, or 2 power or something. This is just quadratic, S square, right? 4S square. So that means if the chromatic number, so give me a number S, positive integer S, and then you tell me that it is a C4 free graph, then you tell me that the chromatic number of the graph is at least 4 square, then we are sure to get all trees on S vertices with all possible orientations. Any whichever orientation you fix, whichever tree you fix on at most S vertices, that will appear as an induced substructure. That is what the theorem is, right? It's a reasonable bound. That is the highlighting thing. It's not that it does not have the exponential and all. Yeah, improving the bound is still open because there is no tightness and all proved. Then we have a different proof also, right? Because we started with a different proof. Finally, Matthew invented a very clever alternative proof, and so that kind of improved the result also. But the earlier proof was actually, which came from Karthik, he was pushing through that proof, and he developed quite a lot by various, it started with simple thing, but it slowly developed. That proof gives a little better bound for a cyclic orientation. Suppose your orientation, the original graph, that means input graph, is oriented, but it is acyclic, no directed cycles are there in it. And also you are only looking for orientations of pattern tree, which is in branching or out branching, right? In that case, we can get a little better, a constant factor better, but there is one good advantage to his proof. We can put a girth condition in the input graph. Now we are saying C4 free, right? Instead of C4 free, what if I say C5 free also? C10 free also. That means up to 10 length cycles are missing in the graph. The girth is high, G. Then we get some considerable improvement. It is S to the power 1 plus 4 by G. That means as G becomes bigger, it gets closer and closer to S. Right? You cannot get smaller than S. So the because there are counter examples, you cannot, that's a tightness, right? So you can only hope to get linear. So, but it's getting closer and closer to S. But Matthew's proof somehow does not seem to work with the girth. But his proof is essentially adaptable to the increasing girth. And the one good thing is about the girth, when we say, okay, you will see why this girth is very interesting for us. In the later part of the, I think I have 15 minutes. I will come back to why that is still very, in spite of Matthew's overriding proof, it's still very useful and powerful in some cases. I'll tell you later. So this, especially you can see that when the girth becomes about log of S, already we are in the linear range, order of S, the chromatic number has to be some constant times S, and then we already guess S length, all trees of S length with the all orientations, right? The other thing is input graph's orientation has to be acyclic, and the in branching and out branchings only can be considered. Sorry. So that is, but all trees is correct. And now the what about considering more specializations of the tree? Suppose tree happens to be just a path. Very special case is a directed path. You might immediately remember the classical Galois-Roy-Vitaver theorem. Some people don't say Vitaver, they say Galois-Roy theorem, which says, you know, this is a very, fascinating theorem at some point of time. It's quite easy to prove, but if you try to prove in a different way, you will start appreciating it, right? Because it says the chromatic number, if the chromatic number of the graph is given, chi of g, so a graph with chromatic number k, then you orient the graph in any way. The edges can be given any directions. Then you are sure to get a oriented path on at least chi vertices, chi of g vertices. This tells us also the chromatic number is essentially that minimum. Suppose if you try all possible orientations, it tries to minimize the longest directed path, and that will give you that chi, right? So somehow it's connecting the chi with orientations. So that's why the Galois-Roy theorem is quite interesting. In spite of the fact that it's easy to prove in a certain way, right? But we'll change from the proof a little bit and try to start appreciating what it is, right? So and then this is Galois-Roy-Vitaver theorem. So our result, when you take a special case of the tree, namely the directed path only, can be seen as a induced variant of the Galois-Roy-Vitaver theorem. Galois-Roy-Vitaver theorem only says that there exists a directed path. Now I demand that I want an indirected induced path on S vertices. So we say Galois-Roy-Vitaver says they need the chromatic number to be at least S. We say at least S square. Then we get an induced directed path itself. In that sense, we can say that it is a induced extension of the Galois-Roy-Vitaver theorem. Now we go to the next variant. The final variant I want to say is the rainbow variant. This is also a question which oriented question also Gerfas asked. He has asked all questions. Something he answered, but many conjectures he made, many of the important conjectures Seymour and Scott and Chudnovsky and that team had settled. Many partial results, many others have, he himself has sometimes given some partial results, but it has been going on this thing, I guess. I think he was a major player in thinking about what will happen when the chromatic number is high. Now this is another question he considered. You have the chromatic number high. Now suppose the chromatic number is k, then you can color the graph, properly vertex color the graph with k colors. It can be optimal, it can be non-optimal, does not matter. Once the chromatic number is k, you color it in some way, such that it is proper, right? Properness is met. Now he demands that you give me an induced tree or path which is rainbow. That means the color should not repeat, right? It should be an induced path or tree. Tree question you can immediately rule out. He himself ruled out, I guess, because not even close are possible. You can't get a vertex with three neighbors as induced close. which is rainbow. However large the chromatic number is, and the graph is triangle free also can be assumed. But C4 free, I don't know, right? But the path question seems to be left. And now we come back to IMSE. The IMSE, you know N.R. Aravind, so he is your student. And he made a conjecture, I mean, I am sure without knowing anything about the GARFA's struggle to get these things done. So he also conjectured his own contribution to this understanding of chromatic number. And I guess many of the students here were also looking at this conjecture at some point of time. His conjecture says that if the chromatic number is high, not high, he conjectured very strong thing. If the chromatic number is K and the graph is triangle free, then there exists, with respect to every proper coloring of it, there exists an induced K length, induced rainbow path on K vertices. The chromatic number is equal to K, then the graph should be triangle free. Otherwise, this is not true, because in a complete graph, for instance, there is no induced path at all, right? So the graph is triangle free and the chromatic number is K, then there exists a multicolored rainbow path on K vertices. All the K vertices will have different this thing. That is a very strong statement to make. You can't do better than that. He says that it will happen, right? But of course, it was not even easy to prove for chi, up to chi equal to 3, it's very easy to see. You can see 3 vertex path is immediate, right? But chi equal to 4 itself was quite difficult. That is, somehow we settled. And then Matthew, myself, and Manu, and Jasin, we had a paper, but which says chi equal to girth, then it will work. Chi equal to girth, it will work. Chi equal to girth, more than girth, is trivial. So the case which it completely settles is chi equal to 4, but otherwise that it was a little effort to prove that itself. And try to make it a little adjustment there. For instance, if you want put chi 2 times s or something and try to get an s path, right? That method seems to be quite crooked. And of course, this was taken up, to N.R. Aravind's credit, this was taken up directly by Scott and Seymour, and of course GARFAS. Of course, he's looking for all the activity in this this kind of thing. I'm sure Aravind did not knew about what this entire business of the GARFAS effort, but GARFAS definitely knew whatever is happening. Immediately he responded to this conjecture by showing that C4 free graphs, if you have a 2s to the power 2s chromatic number, you will get it. I mean, it's exponential, but he showed that, okay, to console Aravind, at least this is correct, right? But then Seymour and Scott, okay, it is also their area now. They responded saying that, look, in fact, not only for triangle free graphs, if you're going to such high functions, and then we can show that for all graphs with clique number bounded by some t, earlier setup, right? Bounded clique graphs, clique number graphs, itself, it is true. If the chromatic number is some super exponential function, they use Ramsey theory all the time. That's a problem, because they have a Ramsey theory and then an exponential function. So therefore, it becomes a little too big to be of any value to state the function. So they say that if the chromatic number is very high, then indeed you will get that induced multicolored rainbow path, right? As this gave us, not only for triangle free graphs, right? When you think about it, you should understand that the oriented paths are not coming. This is coming, right? So the oriented paths with the directed three edge itself is not, even in triangle free, it's not coming. But this will come, is what Scott and Seymour says. And after that, of course, this is the GARFAS-Sarkozy result. But when we look, we beat Garfa-Sarkozy by very wide, significant margin, because our theorem says a tree itself, any orientation will come. Now you take only path, a directed path will come, right? But now you can convert this colorful thing to the path problem, the oriented path problem like this. You have a coloring. Now always orient an edge from a higher numbered color to the lower numbered color. Suppose if an edge will have two different colors at its endpoints, right? Now the orientation will be given in such a way that from the higher color to the lower color, we always orient. Now it becomes an oriented graph. In fact, it will become an acyclically oriented graph, right? And now we can apply our theorem for the oriented variant on this thing. Because once you get a directed path, you can say the color is reducing along the path. No? That is the rainbow path, right? So therefore, we end up getting a rainbow path using some of the special cases of our theorem. And you know, our bound is only S square, quadratic, right? And so compared to 2S to the power 2S of Sarkozy, Garfas and Sarkozy, we are getting S square, and then we are getting that S length colorful path, what this thing. But of course, Arvind wanted S itself, right? So if the chromatic number is S, he wants an S path, right? That is again still quite far. And what Seymour and Scott in their paper kind of mentions is they don't believe that it will be true. And but we are only getting for C4 free, right? He wanted for triangle free. See, when we say C4 free, we are allowing triangle. We are just changing from triangle to C4, right? But C4 is more easier to handle too. That is why somehow it is coming down. The functions are a little better. But triangle, at least Seymour and Scott seems to believe that that may not be correct. But they also say that for chi equal to phi case, at least they worked really hard. And then even the Mysielskian graph with chromatic number chi and all, they really worked it out, and then it is working, right? But they think that for larger values of chromatic number, probably it may not work, right? So so it's not very clear, because many counterexamples are there in the triangle free, as I told, in the oriented case and all. So maybe this also can have a counterexample, right? But it is fundamentally a little different, because they are able to show some function, right? Very large function, such that it happens. While in the other case, it is not even possible to do that, right? There is some difference between that and this. And now we C4 free graphs, we have this S square chromatic number, then we will get a S rainbow path. As Arvind wants the chromatic number to come down a little smaller. And then, as I told, the girth will help here, because if you put the girth a little higher, the requirement of chromatic number is now S to the power 1 plus 4 by G only. So it is much closer to linear, like we are reaching Arvind's dream. Right, and as girth is reaching around log S, we are actually reaching very close to Arvind's dream, namely order of S chromatic number, and you're getting that S vertex rainbow path. But it's Arvind wanted S, not 4S or 5S, right? So that is still difficult to manage. At least the other paper we wrote was a little tough in the sense that to get an improvement looked a little difficult. So that in that sense, it's log S girth allowing us to reach a linear chromatic number requirement to get an S path is quite good. There, for instance, you can try to reduce the girth a little bit from the chromatic number by 2 or something. Still, I mean, it's very unclear how to proceed. It's not that other people haven't tried, right? Even for our paper, the referee response was quite enthusiastic, I should say, once it when I start going in this line, right? With the so, but yeah, that is a little bit of a challenge. I hope somebody will find out a trick to overcome the difficulties there. Yes, this is the thing. Rainbow trees. Yeah, for rainbow trees, I told that for triangle free, it is not possible. But C4 free, maybe it is possible. C4 free, you can show that if it is, Gaffas himself had shown long ago, I think. He calls it folklore, right? Yeah, so that if you just found a subtree, just not an induced subgraph, induced tree, but a tree with rainbow tree, but you can keep some very high chromatic number and you will be able to get all trees, rainbow trees on induced S vertices, not induced. But then once you get that, if you keep a chromatic number even higher and you can extract a induced tree out of that, provided C4 freeness is assumed, right? But that is, yeah, I think almost time. He told 10:30, right? I'm looking at it. So here the C4 freeness is assumed, you can get it. But this will work only for optimal colorings. When I told that Gaffas has done it, only for optimal colorings. If it is not an optimal coloring, I mean, if it's a chromatic number is K, but you color with K plus 1 or K plus 2 colors, it's not clear how even the other result you can get. I mean, all these questions are open and a lot of open questions are there. The difficulty is to figure out which one we should attack, right? So there are so many things to try here. I haven't understood the entire thing till now because when I they have written, Seymour, Scott have written a survey on chi boundedness, and when you, there are so many theorems and conjectures and everything. Karthik will be an expert of all these things, I'm sure. He may tell you more, but in that thing, which corner we should attack is not very clear. There are so many questions and so many variants and so many possibilities which is opened. Because this is an interesting theme, when the chromatic number high and then how do you, I don't know whether if you have time to questions, I can answer, otherwise forget about it. Yes.